I appreciate you coming out today. Hope that you sense that the presence of the Lord is in this place today. And hope that you receive from God's word what he has for you today. I wish I was on the floor. You know, that's what I would like, where I would like to be. So I'm struggling just a bit, but we're videoing this to go online and for our evening session tonight. So we're going to kind of do a little SOS, scoot over some. We've got people still coming in. So if you're around the table, if you'll just get yourself in a comfortable position so you can see and so we can take some notes. You're going to need your Bibles today, and we're going to be in Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. But before we get started with God's Word, a couple of things I need to let you know about. Lots of things, actually, that I want to make you aware of. But you've got a handout, you've got your Bible, so you're getting to the right place. You also have on your table a Thrive newsletter. Will someone grab one of those and just be sure everyone at your table, there you go, has one. If you'll open that up, you'll see on the left-hand side our Bible study program that will be starting the first week of February. So all of the details are there. You can register. We have lots of things available for you to register for tonight. But hopefully you'll look through our newsletter. That's our main avenue to communicate to you things that are going on in women's ministry that will be enriching to you as well. I mentioned I'm Debbie Stuart. It is my great privilege to be the women's minister here at Green Acres. But I am a part of a very important team. Mimi Youngblood, Mimi, raise your hand. We call her the brains behind the operation. She yes, thank you for stopping by. She totally deserves it. Take care of a lot of the details that you'll be involved in for Bible study things. And then Emily Adams in the back. Emily is our director of communications. She's responsible for the beautiful newsletter that you see, our website. All of those creative pieces come from her. And then I feel like a lot has happened since we were together last. Jamie Cornelius has resigned. She has gone into counseling full-time. She's finishing up her master's. And so that requires her to be at Liberty University for several semesters and things like that. So she resigned at the end of the year. And as the Lord would have it, this time very quickly brought in our new team member. And I want to introduce her to you today. This is Taylor. Taylor Ballou, please come up for just a second. I want to tell you a little bit about Taylor. She is a graduate. Let me see where I made my notes about that. Graduate of Mary Harden Baylor with a bachelor in social work, so she's going to work with crazy people. I think that's going to fit perfectly for what she needs. And a minor in Christian studies. There's an obvious call of God on her life towards leadership and impacting the younger generation. So she's going to be focusing on some young girls, young professionals, coming out of college, having a hard time finding their place. Where do they fit? How does ministry work in their life? And how can it be relative? How can we meet the specific needs of that unique generation? So, Taylor, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, of course. I don't know if y'all can hear me. We've got one mic, so I'm going to try to speak loudly. But I'm excited to be here. I've served in student ministry as an intern over there for the past 3 summers. And so I'm excited to be working with women and bringing some younger women to join us in ministry and doing life together. So one of my first groups is actually going to be on young professionals, and so really targeting those 20 and 30 year olds. So thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. It's awesome, Tyler. We are so happy to have her here, and we want young women to know women's ministry is not just the thing that their mother does. It's not just a ministry for their mom. This is a ministry for all generations. This is not a one-size-fits-all, and we're working hard to do that. What other announcements do I need to make? Oh, you'll notice on the back of your handout today, it's called Scripture Worksheet. I'm going to give several scriptures. We won't have time to work through all of those, but there are going to be some words you're going to want to define and some other scriptures you're going to want to jot down. So just letting you know, that is on the back of our worksheet. Hopefully you can work on it when you have some time with the Lord. We video Life Together each month, and we put that online. So if you've missed those in the past, you can go online to greenacreswomen.org under teaching and training. Okay, well, follow us online. That's, again, one of our few avenues of communication to let you know when things are starting and what you can sign up for. One thing that's coming we're so excited about is Tuesday, January 28th, is winter warm-up. You see that on the first page of your handout. I believe there's a sign-up sheet on your table. We're trying to make it very easy for you to sign up for that. We want you to come that night, enjoy desserts with us. And one thing I'm delighted about is you will get to meet the three women that have had the greatest impact in my life. Other than my mom, who has lived in heaven for 30 years, Cora Wilkinson, Trudy Cox, and Julie Shope have made a significant spiritual investment in my life. And they are joining me and coming to see us on the 28th for winter warm-up. And they're going to share some things with you about the importance of mentoring. Because not only does winter warm-up serve to kick off our winter Bible study program, it is also launching our mentoring ministry. We're calling it Flourish. It's a unique mentoring experience rooted in Scripture. So immediately following our life together today, so at 1:15 to 2, we're going to do a Flourish training. I've got a handout for you. It's just 45 minutes. I feel like I'm invading your whole afternoon, but if you'd like to stay, we'd love for you to know more about Flourish, what it means. We haven't communicated a lot during the holidays. It just gets lost in the translation there. So we're going to answer every question, give you a handout with every detail, so you can know what it is, what it is not, how you get involved, how you sign up, and things like that. So we would love for you to stay. If you live close to the Lindale area, we do Life Together Lindale. That's the first Thursday of every month. We're looking at doing a Life Together in Chandler. We've had some requests for that, but we're going to push pause on that for right now, and we're going to get to that as quickly as we can. So this is our new Life Together room. We've been meeting in the Galilee room for the last year. Now, one little change. February only, we need to vacate this room for February. We'll be back in the Galilee room only for February this year. All the other weeks will be in this room. And what I'm hoping and what I'm praying is that we have to start moving the walls back. That you'll begin to bring women with you, and we will fill every table. We just keep moving the walls back to be and to see. We fill up all of Crosswalk. So just make a note next February just to come back to the Galilee room. Many of you know that at our evening Life Together, we host dinner for the Sunshine Lighthouse Girls. That is a transitional home, a faith-based. It's a wonderful ministry. They have a wonderful program. And they've been coming to Life Together every month for about the last, I don't know, 8 or 9 months, maybe even a year. And we feed them dinner at 5:30. We gather together. And so we are looking for those that have the gift of hospitality. If you can help provide it, not a major big meal, but just baked potato and soup or sandwiches or salad, things like that, for them to have dinner with us and then come to our Life Together on Thursday evening. So there's a sign-up sheet for that. So everything that you need and are going to want to know about is right there on your table. So again, if you're new to Life Together, we not only pray together, sometimes we eat together, but we do life together. It's what the Lord intended. In Romans 1:12, now, not what we're going to, we're in 12:1, but Romans 1:12 says that we might be mutually strengthened, encouraged, and comforted by each other's faith, both yours and mine. And that's what Life Together is based on, and that's what we do together. So, before we get started, let me be sure I've made all my important announcements. Let me do a quick update on my sweet husband and my son. If you're new today and you're not sure what's going on about that, my husband last week was added to the heart transplant list. And my son, who has been incarcerated for 10 years, a decade, is being paroled. And so through Life Together and through these messages, the Lord has just developed part of that journey. And so many of you have been following, many of you have been asking. And I appreciate that a great deal. I'm very much aware that I am here today as the result of the prayers of other people. We have gone on the prayers of other people these last 2 weeks. We've had a lot of people in and out of our hospital room. We have signed a lot of documentation. We've had a lot of insurance interviews. And when that settled down just a few days ago, my husband looked at me and he said, what just happened? I said, we have just gone on the prayers of other people. That's what's happened, because we didn't even have a moment at that time as people coming in after the waiting in line at our door to come in to give us the next bit of information, to stop and pray. We were just going on your prayers. And that's what the Lord intends with the body of Christ, that we lift each other up, we build one another up. And I hope today that you feel encouraged by the presence of your friends. I'm encouraged by you being here. And I hope that you'll learn to do that as you come in, that you won't put up a wall, you won't put up a bridge, but you'll come in and just do life with us. So our son is being released on March the 2nd. It's a Tuesday. We have fought the devil every step of the way to get that child home. And what we still do not know is, will we be able to pick him up that day and bring him home, or will we have to watch him get on the bus and go to a halfway house for 2 months, which would be in Dallas? We have a 7-mile issue. If you may raise your hand if you know what I'm talking about. When I say, a 7-mile issue. You need to go back and watch that video, whichever one it was. But we're dealing with the, as a matter of fact, the Lord has told me to stop calling that an issue. So excuse me, forgive me for that. We have a 7-mile thingy. Okay, I don't know. The Lord has said, stop calling that an issue. So it's a thingy. And so that's what we're waiting to hear. Will we pick him up that day, or will it be, he'll go to halfway house? So that's the latest on him. The latest with my hubby is, when he was on the heart transplant list, the next step, which is very close to a heart transplant, there are two steps before that, you get an IV, you get a PICC line, and he begins to start on IV meds. There are only two kind of meds that you can take for that. Last week he was on one. He could not tolerate that. And got very sick. Only 5% of the people cannot tolerate that particular drug. So they put him in the hospital to start him on the other one. There's only two. During that process, they realized they cannot start him on the other one. He has other electrical heart issues. If they started him on the other one, we're going to be in a lot of trouble. So they took him off all of the IV meds. So he's in Baylor Medical Center right now. He is part of the reason I'm here. He's insisted that, I think y'all insisted I stay with him, and he insisted that I come here. So I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. But the Lord reminded me early on when I started this message, which was about 3 weeks ago, working on the handout, that you'll notice at the very bottom of the handout, the very last thing that it says that we'll be talking about is your strength comes from the Lord. The Lord is my strength and my shield, and I trust him with all my heart. He helps me, and my heart is filled with joy, and I burst out in songs of thanksgiving. So at this part, we're going to be with doctors tonight. They have our transplant team consists of 9 doctors, and they met this morning over all of their inpatients, and they met about him this morning. They'll come around to our room around 7 or 8 o'clock tonight and let us know what they recommend in our next step. It's probable the next step will be that he just comes home to wait for a heart. If he gets sicker, he'll have to wait in the hospital for a heart. So that's how you can pray for us. It's just for medical wisdom, and that the Lord will give him, as Ezekiel says, a new heart and a new spirit. He's doing great. The Lord blessed me with a man with a strong heart. Not a physical strong heart, but he blessed me with a man that has a strong heart. So as we start today, I want to do what the Bible says right there in Psalm 28:7. It says, I burst out in a song of thanksgiving. Would you just close your eyes for a moment? We're going to play this one song. And would you let the Lord minister to you as a result of this song?
As I rise, strength of God, go before, lift me up. As I wake, eyes of God, look upon, be my sight.
Before
Positioning ourselves for 2020, for this year, for every moment of this year. This year is going to be built by consistent groups of boxes joined together. If you do old school calendar, raise your hand if you do old school calendar, right? Then you've got boxes side by side by side, and those make up a month. And before you know it, all of those boxes have been combined together to make up a year. What is going to happen? How are you going to position yourself in 2020 for the work that God intends to do in your life? Maybe the unexpected things that the Lord is going to bring in your life. We're working through right now. The truth is, some of us are dealing with what the Lord has given us. This is what He has allowed. This is the road that He has us on. How will we respond? So you're in Romans chapter 12. I want to read a scripture for you. I'm going to read New Living Translation. This is not on your handout, so just jot that down, and you can work through this scripture on the back if you'd like, but this is Romans 12:1. How exactly are we going to position ourselves for this year? And I'm praying that this year doesn't turn out to be the same crazy, frenzied, overwhelmed, exhausting year like it has been in years past, where we're just glad when the day is over. Before you know it, at the end of the year, we're so glad this year is over. I'm just so glad it's over. But I want this year to represent something that has changed and something that is different in your life, and that the Lord accomplishes something that He is going for in your life. So He tells us a couple of things that we're going to make into practical application. Today we're going to talk about position, patterns, and practices. Position, how we position ourselves for what the Lord has allowed, for what the Lord assigns us to do. Position, patterns, and practices. Y'all know my sweet grandson was here over the holidays. My daughter and son-in-law were here and got to stay with us for a week. So we had our little five-year-old Clark and our two-year-old Luke. I could spend the rest of the day telling you Clark and Luke's story. They are hilarious. But I want to tell you two. I'm going to tell you one now about Clark. When we were at the table, he loves activities. The kid loves school. He's like his Dodie. That's my grandmother named Dodie. So I always do activity sheets for him. And so he said, Dodie, I want to make up my own activity sheet. So I said, okay. I got him a blank sheet of paper, and I said, what activity do you want to do? He said, I'm going to do patterns. He's in kindergarten now, so they're teaching patterns. So he drew a star, he drew a heart, and he drew a house. And then he looked at me and he said, watch this, Dodie. And he drew another star, another heart, and another. I said, that's a pattern. He said, it's only stars, it's only hearts, it's only houses. It's a pattern. And the whole sheet was nothing but stars, hearts, and houses. And he was trying to explain to me, this is what a pattern. You can't add anything else to it. You can't, this is all like this every time. And at the end he said, it's these three things all the time. That's what a pattern is. And I want to flip that to the spiritual side for us today. It's these things all the time. That's what create pattern. That's what will create a pattern in your life. Are you developing healthy patterns in your life? Patterns, we also refer to as habits, healthy habits that we have developed or that even have been modeled for us in our family of origin. But God's Word tells us in Romans chapter 1, I'm going to read from the New Living, from NIV first, and then the New Living Translation. It says this, and I'll make it feminine for us today. Therefore, I urge you, sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world. Circle that word pattern. I do not conform. Your translation might say behavior. To the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and to approve what God's will is. His good, pleasing, and perfect will. I can't tell you how many times I meet with women across my table, and that's the number one question that I get. How do I know what God's will for my life is? How do I know what God's will in this situation? What do I need to do? I love this verse because I'm all about do this. I'm all about a list. Anybody else? I love it. Do this, don't do this, check this off. This is what you do. This is how. You know, like any question. So it lists for us. Don't be conformed, but be what? Yeah, your enthusiasm is overwhelming to me. Do not be conformed, but be what? Transformed. To be transformed. That activity and pattern is on us. The Bible does not say, I will transform you so that you don't. You are not to do this pattern, this way, this behavior. You're to do it this way. And it tells us how. How are we to do it? What does the Bible say? By the renewing of your mind. We're going to unpack that, what that actually means, in just a second. But as we develop patterns, position, pattern, and practices, I love a good list to tell us how to do that. It is so cool in God's Word. Let me read this to you. It's kind of strong language, so some of you don't get your feelings hurt, okay? So look at your friend and say, don't get your feelings hurt. When you look up that word renewing, When you look it up in the original language, so it's Greek. If you're new to Bible study, the Old Testament is written in Hebrew. The New Testament is written in Greek. And so our English words were translated from Hebrew to English and Greek to English. I love the original language because it defines words differently than the English language. So when I'm thinking renew in the English language, I'm just thinking, oh, I need to just do better. You know, I just need to redo, maybe kind of renovate. This is the word. This is what it means. The word is anakinesis. Anakinesis. And it means this. A renewal. If you're going to renew your mind, what exactly are you going to do? The definition is a renewal, a renovation. I love this. Complete change for the better. That means changing of your patterns and things that you're doing. Now, this is where it kind of gets hard. If you drill it down, so it has that original Greek word. That original Greek word is actually made up of two root words. So there's two root words together put together to make a kinesia. And when you drill it down to the root word, what does the root word mean? You know what it means? Mm-mm. But that's good. To grow up. Oh, yeah. I don't know if y'all are going to have that expression. Okay, can you receive this? To renew your mind is to what?
Grow up.
And some of you are going, no, she did not just tell me to grow up. Yes, I did. Yes, I did. Straight from God. That was shocking to me in a way, to cause to grow up, to make new, to give new strength and new vigor, a new kind of life opposed to the former state. So a new kind. If you want a new life for 2020, what I want us to do is get to the end of this year, and we have said to the Lord, we have offered you the best life possible as an offering to you. Did you get to the end of 2019 and were you able to say to the Lord, I have patterned my life. I have positioned myself to offer you the best life possible. All those things that you brought in and that you allowed in and you asked me to work with and to work through, I did to the best of my ability. Not me. So I need to make some changes. I need to grow up. I need to renovate some things in my life. If you've ever been around any length of time, one of the patterns that we challenge each other with regarding how we spend our day, specifically speaking, 20 minutes, what is the challenge that we have around here?
20 minutes every day.
There you go. 20 minutes a day for the rest of your life. You develop that pattern. You position yourself with the Lord every day. Just 20 minutes to start there. And it gets to turn into something different and something bigger than that. Start there. I got a text from a sweet friend of mine, Tony, actually, your sweet daughter, Leanne Kirkendall. Y'all have heard her speak a couple of times here. She texted me this week, and we were texting about several things, and then finally she let me know that her mother-in-law had gone to heaven. She said she is in the presence of Jesus. And I was reading that in the hospital room, and I thought to myself immediately, what a great place to be. My mother-in-law is in the presence of Jesus. Do you know that you don't have to wait till you die to be in the presence of Jesus? Yeah, yes, the tangible let me reach out and touch you presence, yes. But in that moment, when I'm sitting on the side of a hospital bed, you know what the Lord is reminding me about? You can be in my presence anytime you want, sweetheart. That's on you. That's for you to decide. My presence is available to you 24/7. But you have neglected it. You have been distracted from it. You have made other choices. You develop other patterns in your life. And by doing so unintentionally, you did not renew. Unintentionally, day by day, you did not renew your mind. And just a little side note here from like, David, I'll come to church on Sunday. Girl, if that's all you're doing is making it to church on Sunday morning, the enemy's going to suck that out of you before you leave the parking lot. Okay, we have to develop a pattern, daily pattern, that we build God's word into our life, that we build the principles of God's word into our life. So let me talk just a second about positioning yourself to be in the presence of the Lord. So Moxley Clark, he's wired for basketball. Since he was little, that's his thing, basketball. So they put him on the basketball team. He had his first basketball game last Saturday. I was smitten. I was smitten watching this little boy. I had to watch him on video. They live in Seattle, Washington area. Anyway, while he was here, he was telling me all about basketball. He's getting to wear a jersey. But then he was telling me, I have to be on the team. See, he's only played basketball with his family, with his dad, and with his daddy. But he said, I'm going to be on the team now. He said, we have team players. And he was telling me all about the team. We have a team jersey and all about the team. And so I didn't know. I mean, he's five. I didn't know what I would teach them. And I asked him, well, Clark, what is your position on the team? I know basketball. They have the guard and the forward and the center, whatever. I said, what is your position on the team? He looked at me and said, I'm a shooter. Pass the ball to anybody else. That was clear on his first game. Very clear. It was really quite funny. Watch him run up and down and take the ball and hit it in the hoop, run it down this way. And his teammates, well, some of them were just standing there. He's watching. He's the shooter. You know, and so I love that position. You know, I'm doing the main thing here. I'm gonna do the main thing. That's what's so important to you. So as we are not conformed by the patterns or the habits of this world, even to a degree of our own families. That includes patterns of thinking, patterns of spending, not just money, but patterns of spending time, patterns of behavior, things that get replayed over and over in our mind. I'll tell you one that's played over and over in my mind, especially in regards to our son. I cannot do this anymore. Yeah, I cannot do this anymore. Anybody? Okay, other patterns of thinking in our life is I'm out on this. I'm done. I'm not doing this another day. And we check out. Another pattern and way of thinking is I will never forgive them for that. I will never forgive. I'm done. I'm done with this marriage. I'm done with this child. I'm done with this job. And before you know it, we develop these patterns. And what has happened is that's something that the enemy has spoken into your life. He's spoken that in. You don't have to do this. You can't do this. You're not strong enough for this. You're never going to amount to anything. He's not worth the fight anymore. Just walk away. And so the enemy has just any little dart that he can, he'll shoot at you to see what sticks, so to speak. And what I have found myself doing, and this is why renewing your mind is so important, I have found myself repeating what the enemy has said to me. You can't do this anymore. Before you know it, I walk around my house and I'm like, I can't do this. I'm not going to do this. And I developed this. Are there any other patterns of thinking? Speaking things? What else maybe have you said? Would you be honest and transparent enough? I always try to be very transparent with you. What are some other patterns? Not you, the heathen girls that didn't come today. What are things that you know they are thinking, that they've said to themselves? What's the other thing? That wasn't fair. It's never going to change. This is not going to work. I'll never be good enough.
I have a right.
I deserve better than this. He continues to hurt them. This will never end. It will always be this way. There's nothing good that can come out of this, of a son that's been in prison for 10 years. I'm here to tell you, we have watched the Lord transform him into a different person. Any others? You see how we develop these patterns of thinking? Turn in your Bibles, please, to Exodus chapter 1. I'm just going to hit on this quickly because I'm going to really unpack it in Bible study. I've already mentioned to you how important Bible study and being in the teaching of God's Word with a group of women. I hope that you'll join in a Bible study, get signed up for that. But I came across this recently and it was just so overwhelming to me that I just want to hit on this perfect setup for today in Exodus chapter 1. While you're turning, and this is about the Israelites and about their desire for the Lord for them to be released from captivity. While you're turning there, let me just tell you to be honest and just as transparent as I can with you about these patterns and about positioning ourselves and the practices that we have. I developed one really unintentionally over the holidays. I had a little time off, and the kids were here, and then they went to the other in-law's house, and so we had a little time. And I didn't mean to do this. I didn't plan to do this. This is why renewing your mind every day is so important. But intentionally, you know, I developed this pattern. I developed this practice of, let's just call it, scrolling. Don't look at me like that. I developed this little pattern called scrolling. And in the afternoon, when I'm sitting down, I'm looking at stuff. Oh, that's good. I'm looking at stuff. Anybody? Anybody? I'm just scrolling. What did she have to say about that? What was she like that? I wonder what she said. The Lord got on me about that. About all of this stuff. I didn't intend to do that. I don't even really like doing it. It's not adding value to my life. But before I knew it, every day at a certain time, and then here's the crazy thing. This was like 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I just had a little cup of coffee out of my mouth, and I'm just scrolling. Listen, I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm not here to judge anybody on anything that you do. Lord knows, I wouldn't do that. I've got my own crazy going on. But I'm here to ask you, is it the best use of your time? That's my question. Is it adding value to the life that you're trying to offer the Lord Jesus? You're welcome. So, here's what I started doing that about 3 o'clock in the morning. So, before I knew, like an hour was gone, I was going to believe it. And then at night, I get in my pajamas, I get in the bed, you know what I start doing? Twice a day, I'm stroked. And the Lord said, stop. Stop this craziness. You are developing, the enemy is so slight, I developed a pattern that I did not want in my life. And so I had to make some changes and grow up. Mm-hmm. And so, just a little side note there. So as we are looking at patterns, the Israelites give us the best example of this because they started right and they did not finish right. They started well, but they did not finish strong. And if any group of people could have done it, it would have been them. They were God's chosen people. I want to show you how they started. They developed this pattern that was so right. And somewhere along the line, I'm sure unintentionally, I'm sure they never planned, they changed this pattern. They changed this practice. And they never entered the promised land as a result. It was not the enemy that kept them out of the promised land. It was their attitude that kept them out of promise. It was their whining and complaining and their unbelief. But here's how they started, which was so encouraging to me. And again, I'm going to unpack this in Bible study, so not here, but just get this in your mind just as an overview. So they're getting ready to come, they're going to be getting ready to come out of captivity. But when they're in slavery, chapter 1, verse 8 says this, while they're in slavery, and this is so important, it says, then a new king came to the throne of Egypt who knew nothing about Joseph or what he had done. Now, I'm going to stop there for 1 second. I'm going to stop after every scripture, I promise. But what is that? You've got all of these people that have been watching the Lord work in their life in an unbelievable way. And then the new king of Egypt comes on the scene and he knows nothing about Joseph. He knows nothing about God. He knows nothing about these people. How can he not know? How could he not know what God had been doing all of this time in their life? Somebody didn't tell somebody. That's how it got to be. He didn't know. One generation failed to tell the next generation. And the Bible tells us you are responsible for the next generation. It's one of the reasons we brought Taylor. We're responsible for the generation of women coming up. Somebody didn't tell somebody how great God was. Somebody didn't tell somebody, these people, we're following Yahweh. We are following Jehovah God. He is our God. He is our ruler. He is our king. Don't need another king. We're God's people. Nobody said a word. Nobody told anybody what God had done. So there rose a king. He hadn't heard a thing about it. And he could care less. And they did not say. So verse 11 says, well, it goes on to say the people got such a large number of people, the king began to get a little worried about that. So he decided to do this. So the Egyptians made, verse 11. So the Egyptians made the Israelites their slaves. And he put brutal slave drivers over them. Listen to this. This is New Living Translation. Hoping to wear them out under a heavy burden. Let's just translate it in terms of application for us. The enemy seeks to wear you out under heavy burdens. You know that in Daniel, the Bible says that in the last days, the enemy seeks to wear out the saints of the Most High? That's what he's looking to do right now. What am I going to do today to wear her out? What are you looking to do today that's going to renew your mind so that the wearing out never happens? He said, we're going to oppress them. So he tried to wear them out with these heavy burdens. They forced them to build the cities with bricks, and the more Egyptians oppressed them, get this in your brain, on the sticky side of your brain, the more the Egyptians oppressed them, the more quickly they multiplied or grew. The more they were oppressed, the more they were burdened, the more they were hurt, the more they grew. Can you flip that to the spiritual side? Is that what's happening in our lives today? The more I'm oppressed, the more I am hurt, the more all of those patterns we just said of thinking, the more that happens, the more I grow spiritually. The stronger that I become. Is that what's happening? And it goes on to say, the more that happened, the more quickly they multiply. So they started out well. That's a great pattern to develop. That's a great position. That's a great practice. And then it says this, the Egyptians soon became alarmed. And get this, they decided to make their slavery more bitter still. The enemy made their captivity more bitter still. And that's what the enemy seeks to do in your life, to make you more bitter still. But you have the weapons. It's a spiritual fight. It's a spiritual battle. And you have spiritual weapons to fight the with. So I just wanted to visit to draw that out. As they started that pattern, that's the pattern I want us to develop. They started right, but then they began to complain and whine, and they did not end up where God wanted them. Positioning ourselves to be ready for God's work in our life this year is so important, and we're told how to do that. This year is going so, we're in the middle of January already. Like, January's almost gone. Let's not let 2020 become just another year of chaos, another year of regrets. And let's not say that we're going to get stuck in those patterns of the past. That's a big thing that we need to change. That's what the renewing of the mind, renew, renovate, to change, to rebuild any patterns of the past in your life. Young moms, look at me. You are right now developing daily patterns, daily behaviors in your life that your children will have to live with for the rest of their life. What you're doing right now on a day-to-day basis, whether you mean to or not, whether it's intentional or not, it just began to happen that way. You never meant for it to. And some of those little ones, as they grow up, they're going to have to receive counseling as a result of daily patterns that you are developing in your life. Right now, let me ask you a question. I hope you'll just be transparent. Raise your hand if you have somehow been hurt by the unhealthy, destructive, or dysfunctional patterns or habits of other people. Raise your hand. Come on. Some of us in counseling for today, because someone developed a pattern and we had to live with it. We had to live on it. We saw the cutest thing with our little Luke. He's two. And I could see he got this from his mother without question. It's a pattern that she developed. She didn't realize she was doing it, and I'm not saying there was anything really major wrong with it at all. But she developed this little phrase of "it's fine, it's fine, it's fine." So if something happens and something he doesn't eat stuff on his plate or whatever, so it's fine. If he falls down or any little thing that happens, she'll tell him, "It's fine, it's fine. Look, it's fine, it's fine." That's what she said. It's fine. So he started repeating that. We're in the backyard, and he loves watering my plants. He had a little water bucket, and he's watering my plants, and he went from this plant to this plant and went right over his shoe. His whole shoe got wet. I said, "Boo, you just watered your shoe." He said, "It's fine. It's fine." He's on this little scooter coming down the driveway. He falls and scrapes his knee to the point that it needs a band-aid. I said, "Buddy, let me see your knees. It's fine. It's fine. Everything, whatever, it's fine." You know why? Because that's what his mother walks around. "It's fine, Clark, it's fine. Look, it's fine. It's fine." As in, we're not going to deal with that, we're not going to worry about what it's just fine. So when we were in the hospital last week, and the doctors came in and gave us all this news, and they walked out, my husband looked at me and said, "It's fine." No, it's not fine. but you develop, hey, you know the wrong with it, it's fine. It's just like, hey, well, you know, there's where I'm going to spend time on it, I'm not going to deal with it. But you develop patterns that other people have to live by. I was just thinking about little things that we were doing. We didn't need to, but now it's the three things that we do everything. It's the little heart, it's the little house, it's the little star. Da, 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 over and over and over. They also always say hindsight is 20/20. Do we not? Looking back, we can learn a lot by looking back. And so my challenge today is that we look back and that we set up 20/20 for success in a way, for spiritual success. Not really financial or all these other ways, that's all great, but spiritually set it up for success. Here's what Charles Spurgeon wrote about the Israelites. I have a Charles Spurgeon Bible. I love his analogies on things. And this is what he says about the Israelites. That is kind of in play in my life right now. See if it's in play in yours. The first thing to be done with the Israelites was to cause them to be anxious to come out of Egypt. For it is not God's way to make people his servants, except so far as they willingly yield themselves to him. He never violates human will, though he constantly and effectually influences it. Anybody? Oh, yes, he does. But he's not going to make you walk with him this year. He's not going to make you do that. Another thing Spurgeon said about the Israelites is this. I put this on a little sticky note. This is just overwhelming to me. Had it been another people, so other than the Israelites, had it been another people, the tactics might have succeeded. The whole make them bitter steel. That might have succeeded. But they were God's people, endeared to him by their ancestry, ennobled in his sight by their covenant destiny, and encompassed with his favor like a shield that could not be penetrated. Throw that in the tadpole slap away. I'm talking. Take that. When you look at your eternal, your covenant destiny, you're God's chosen people. And he has endeared you. He has ennobled you. I love it, to be ennobled by his covenant destiny and encompassed with his favor as a shield that cannot be penetrated. I know some of you are probably thinking, my, you are just on a tangent today. You're a little high strung, a little wound up. I am. I am because perspective on life has changed for me abruptly. And now all of a sudden, the way I want to produce life and every breath that I breathe, I want it to accomplish the plan and purpose of God. All of a sudden, it's very, very precious. We're living heartbeat to heartbeat right now. And sometimes life has a way when unexpected things come in, you'll change your perspective. But today, I'm sharing with you probably way too personally and overwhelmingly, probably sharp, that, because I don't want something like that to have to happen to you. I want us today to decide without the need of an overwhelming change in our perspective because something major happened. This is a wake-up call. I believe the Lord is waking us. I believe there's a spiritual awakening coming to women. And I believe there is a shaking coming to women. And he's asking, what are we doing? What are you doing with your life? Don't live life and miss the point. Amen. You just go through emotions. You just check stuff off a box. You just get through another day and you miss the point of what God was going for your entire life. There is so much at stake that we don't even realize. Things are connected to us that we haven't even seen yet. Are the patterns, are the practices, are the positions that you are taking right now, are they honoring to the Lord? I have a great little prayer book that I read every morning. And it's a morning and evening. It's a diary of private prayers. One of my favorite things. And this last week, this is one of the things that it asks you to consider. In the prayer book, it says this, do not let, I was talking about, well, let me start from the beginning. that God has given us the night time for rest and that there's time for work and service. Do not let it produce laziness in us, but instead let it encourage more diligent action and willing obedience. Teach me, O God, to use all the circumstances of my life today to nurture the fruits of the Spirit rather than the fruits of sin. Let me use disappointment as material for patience. Let me use success as material for thankfulness. Let me use anxiety as material for perseverance and danger as material for courage. Let me use criticism as material for learning. Let me use praise as material for humility. Let me use pleasures as material for self-control and pain as material for endurance. On the rest of your handout today, there's some scriptures I hope that you'll go through maybe with a group of women that you travel with, or maybe just personally. It's raining all afternoon. It'd be a great time to spend some extended time with the Lord. But I've listed here for you as we bring this to a close, Ephesians 3:20. That's where I kind of develop, position yourself for 2020 from Ephesians 3:20. I have a reminder set on my phone every day that it dings me at 3:20 every day, this verse. Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think according to the power that works in us. Another translation says that he can do more abundantly. Another translation says immeasurably more. But what I love about that is the power that works where? In you. It's the power of God at work in your life. Oh, there'll be evidence for sure. Other people will be able to see it. It works in you. That little Greek word is two words together. That works is really one Greek word. Enterego, to be operative, to be powerful, to display one's ability. It's that the Lord is working in you. And you see that Greek word, enterego. What is our English word we get from that?
Energy.
That he gives us the spiritual energy. He is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above and beyond. What else do we need? 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to make all grace abound to you so that, anybody know what I'm talking about when I say so that? We've got a so that message. You need to go back and read that. Why does God allow certain things? It is so that he can be glorified. Oh, and I watched a video. Have y'all seen the video of Lois Evans' funeral? The tribute that her son, Jonathan, did. It is worth your time. It's not that long. Go and look. Lois Evans had a memorial service, Tony Evans' wife. And her youngest son, Jonathan, did a great tribute to her. Here's one of the things that he said that just hit me between the eyes. He said this, that the Lord had reminded him as they were praying for healing, as they were praying for her to be healed and that she would be able to live and be a testimony to God's faithfulness. He said the Lord reminded him, hey, don't tell me how to get my glory. Don't tell me how to get my glory. The Lord allows certain things in our life so that he can be glorified. But we don't tell him how to do that. We all need that reminder. He shares it, so it's a great thing to look at. But my God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. And I'll just add to that my own personal prayer, every day, day by day, step by step, every day you will have and abound in every good work. We talk about, and we close with this, our time is gone, so much I wish we could talk about it. But we talk about asking the Lord for a word for the year. Anybody got a word from the year? I hope you'll just maybe spend some time sharing that with those at your table. But just ask the Lord to give you a word for 2020. Something he wants you to focus on, something maybe a banner over your life he wants to develop in your life or equip you for, prepare you for, use you for. So my word for 2020 is through. Kind of a strange word. T-H-R-O-U-G-H. Through. It gives the definition that you start on one side and you make it to the other side, through. But I've lived long enough and counseled enough women to know so many of us get stuck in the middle. It's happened to me. We don't get through. We don't get to the other side. We don't make it through. We don't work through. We don't get through because we get stuck in the middle. Usually, it's a pattern we had developed that keeps us stuck. Some practice, some pattern, keeps us from making it to the other side. The Bible says in Isaiah 43:2, when you go through, so I'd love you to unpack this scripture, maybe on the back side of this. When you go through deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. Not if you go through. What's the word?
When.
When you, not your neighbor. The Lord's talking, when you, comma. You should put your name there, Debbie. When you go through. Not when you get in. When you go through. When you make it all the way to the other side of it stuff. Deep waters or great trouble. There's a promise there. I will be with you. The presence of the Lord is right there with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you go through the fires of oppression, you will not be burned. Through God's power at work in you, that's what the Bible says. I'm trying to work my power out in you. Is he able to do that to the full effect that he would like? Is it working in you? Through God's power working in you, you will go through this. One of the reasons that I've seen women get stuck is they get distracted through different patterns of life. So I wrote this quote I read. I wish I could give credit to who said it, but it says this: the things you are distracted by, so that's usually the things that get you stuck all the way through. The things you are distracted by are not as important as the things you are distracted from. I assure you, if the enemy is distracting you to something else, it's because maybe, perhaps, he's gotten a glimpse of where you're going, and he's going to do, this is what he said, not on my watch, he's not. I will make her bitter still. I will oppress her. I will wear her out so that she does not make progress. I wonder what the enemy is trying to distract you from in 2020, in this year. I want to close with Psalm 28:7. Your strength comes from the Lord. You can do all things through him who strengthens you. The Lord is my strength and my shield. I trust him with all my heart. He helps me, and my heart is filled with joy. I burst out in songs of thanksgiving. Is that what you burst out in? Or has a pattern caused you to burst out in something else? She burst out in her crazy. That's what happened. She didn't burst out in thanksgiving. She burst out in crazy. Would you say your strength comes from the Lord? Say, my strength. Would you say that with me? My strength comes from the Lord. My help comes from the Lord. There may be days of this year you have to stand and look yourself in the mirror so that the enemy can overhear your conversation and tell yourself, my strength comes from the Lord. My strength comes from the Lord. And I want to close and just ask you to consider the patterns and the practices and the positions in your life right now today. Are there any perspectives that need to be changed? Are you able to offer the Lord the best life that you can, a life of faith? The Bible says faith comes by and hearing by the word of God, that you're in God's word. The Bible also says don't be hearers only, but be doers. That's practice. Practicing God's word. Let's pray.